Welcome to Authenticity, Belonging, Community, where I explore the ABCs of inclusivity by conversing with interesting guests from a variety of fields and disciplines about how they foster inclusive workplaces and communities. I've crossed paths with Tim Wise numerous times over the many years of doing this work, and I am constantly in awe of his mind, his writing, and his take on what's happening in the realm of anti-racism in America. Whenever I hear him speak, I know I will walk away with a new and different understanding of race and privilege. There's a lot of gems in this conversation, and it goes by fast, so listen up, listen in, and get ready to absorb a masterclass. Welcome to Incognito, the podcast. I'm your host, Michael Fosberg, and with me today is Tim Wise. He is among the nation's most prominent anti-racist educators and authors. He has spent the past 30 years lecturing on matters of racism and racial bias in all 50 states on over 1,500 college campuses at hundreds of professional and academic conferences and to corporate, nonprofit, and community groups throughout North America. He is the author of 8 books, including his highly acclaimed memoir, White Like Me, Reflections on Race from a Privileged Son, and his latest essay collection, Dispatches from the Race War. He has contributed essays or chapters to 25 additional volumes, and his writings have appeared in dozens of popular magazines and newspapers and scholarly journals. He's a frequent commentator on CNN, MSNBC, and NPR, and his speeches have been viewed over 30 million times on various social media platforms. He has served as adjunct faculty at Smith College School for Social Work and was the 2008 Oliver Brown Distinguished Visiting Scholar for Diversity Issues at Washburn University in Topeka, Kansas. He has served on the advisory boards of the Fisk University Race Relations Institute, the African American Policy Forum, and the National League of Cities Racial Equity and Leadership Team. He's a graduate from Tulane University in 1990 and received anti-racism training from the People's Institute for Survival and Beyond, both in New Orleans. And he is the host of the podcast Speak Out with Tim Wise. Tim, welcome to the podcast.
Thanks for having me. Good to see you.
It's good to see you. Good to have you on the podcast. Our paths have crossed numerous times over the years, and I'm a big admirer of your work. That's a very impressive, and I didn't even use, there's so many other things that you've been engaged and involved with, from television projects to all kinds of things, movies and whatnot. And as you know, I'm obsessed with identity being the core of my work. I read that and I think, I don't know, what do you probably hear your bio read, I mean, hundreds of times. How does it make you feel when you hear all that?
I mean, I sort of zone out for it a little bit. Because, you know, I wrote it because I was taught early on how to, one of the things that I did in a former life before I really had steady employment doing anti-racism or social justice work, I was sort of in between gigs and I used to write resumes for people who needed resumes to be written. And so I know how to write good copy for bios. I can make everybody sound like the most qualified person for whatever job they're trying to get. When I hear my own read back to me, I'm like, yeah, but that, I mean, it's all true, but I'm sure I make it sound a lot better than it really is. I'm a pretty normal guy who, yes, if you do something for 33 years, you know, anybody that does anything for 33 years is supposed to have a few accomplishments. So I don't make a lot out of it. I'm trying not to be faux humble here, but no, I mean, it's fine. It's, you know, at least you didn't read the really long version. I've been at speeches where people read like the 5-minute version. They read the name of every book that I've contributed to. It's just like, let's move on, you know?
Right. And you mentioned, you know, it's this whole list of accomplishments, but it doesn't, well, some of it does say a little bit about who we are personally, but most of the times it doesn't really address who we are personally, how we see ourselves. And so my question is, how do you see yourself? What are the core identities to how you see yourself in the world?
Yeah, it's a great question. And I think bios do elide a lot of that. It's just about accomplishment. It's not really about who we are. For me, I mean, you know, I'd like to say that, I mean, I consider my identity as a father. I've got two amazing daughters who are really the biggest things that I've accomplished in life are contributing to them. That's for sure. And their existence and their development. You know, obviously I consider myself an anti-racism educator, and that's a little bit different title than some. I go places where they'll say, you know, why is this activist? And I mean, I've done activism, but I sort of think activism is a really special term that one has to almost earn. And I think there was a time when I earned it, and I haven't really been doing activist-y stuff. I'm not a community organizer any longer. I was, 20 some odd years back, 27, you know, years ago or whatever, almost 30 years ago, actually. But now I consider myself an educator, a writer, an essayist, you know, a troublemaker of various sorts, and have sort of settled into that mode of trying to educate rather than agitate. I appreciate agitators. They're very important. But I think that agitation is for certain people are really good at it. They're really good activists. They're really good organizers. And I don't want to take that title from the people who really deserve it more. So I'll stay in my lane, you know, which is raising a certain degree of consciousness and awareness, trying to touch people with what I guess can be considered various forms of art. That is to say, the spoken word of my speeches, that is to say, the essays that I write, and watch with amazement as these mostly younger people do incredible activism around the world on a whole lot of different issues.
Yeah, I would imagine that you have come across the word woke a few times in your travels, and that you perhaps have been perhaps labeled as such. Is that true or not?
Well, the Root magazine referred to me as one of the 8 wokest white people they know. And I should point out that my dear friends at the Root, as much as I love them, I do find it funny that they could only find 8. First off, who does a list with 8 of anything? Like, you couldn't even find 10. Like, you know, you stopped at 8. You're like, oh, there's not even a 9. Let's just do 8. And I'm pretty sure I was number 8, but I'd like to think that that was just because it was alphabetical. I don't know for sure.
Okay.
so yes, I have been called that. You know, I'm glad to wear that as a label. I do think now that that term has been so pilloried by the right and caricatured by the right, that it now becomes one of those labels when people say it. Even when I hear the bio read, that sometimes people will add that the Root called me that. And I sort of feel weird about it. I sort of feel weird about it, like, not because I have a problem with being what I think woke is, which is aware of ongoing systemic injustice and concerned about altering it, but because people hear that and they think it just means that you're some killjoy who can't laugh about anything and all you think about is oppression and you go around telling everybody how awful the world is. That's not, of course, what it means. But if somebody hears that about me, they're going to go like, oh, you're one of those, you know, people. And that's unfortunate that the right has done that to this otherwise completely valid concept.
Yes, it's really a shame. And it's the label, as you so aptly put it, the label being worn, having to wear that label then has so many different meanings for so many different people. So, and it's complicated. So have you ever felt walking into a room that your identity was or might be an obstacle?
Sure. You know, as a white person doing this work, when you start off doing it, at least for me, I'm not going to say this is true for everyone. A lot of people are woefully unaware of how whiteness plays in anti-racist spaces. But I was, as you mentioned in the bio, I was trained by, you know, folks at the People's Institute in New Orleans, and they were really good about making sure that the white folks that they worked with had a real sense of our identity, not as a badge of shame or dishonor, because their argument was, mine is, that racism is a systemic force. It's an institutional force. It's not about good people and bad people and white people are evil and all the non-white folks of color are noble. Their analysis was much deeper than that, as is mine today. And so they taught me to sort of walk into those spaces with a degree of humility, but also a purpose, not to feel, you know, not to feel either ashamed or that I needed to come in and take over the room, you know, trying to find that space between being too demonstrative and being a wallflower. Right. And so in that sense, I remember early on being very conscious that when I went into a space, you know, I wanted to listen at least as much as I spoke, if not considerably more, because I knew that my identity would cause in any certainly any Black person in America, would cause them to wonder, like, you know, sort of make that thing that dogs do when they hear a high-pitched whistle, like, I don't know, what is that? Like, because there aren't a whole lot of white folks who have consistently stuck with that kind of work over longer periods of time. There have been more than most know, but not nearly enough. And I'm sure that for Black and brown folks, there's a skepticism. So I've been very aware of that. I've been aware of that in when I was a community organizer. I was a community organizer in New Orleans, in public housing communities, where 97% of the residents, I think, were Black. And of course, they were all poor, lower income. And I was very aware, both as a white person, as someone who was educated at Tulane and had the trappings of middle class, you know, status or even upper middle class status, even though my income was not upper middle class, I had a certain cultural capital from my education, right, that I could carry with me in places. I was hyper alert to that. And I think I'd like to think it made me a better organizer because I was aware and I was thinking and trying to be mindful of how I moved in that space. But I also know that there have been times I've moved in the space in a very clumsy way. So that happens too, yeah, you know.
Sure. So moving in spaces like that, that you've just described and whatnot, how do you go about creating an environment that is conducive to collaboration? What methods do you use?
For me, there's just sort of a constant check-in with the things I don't know. You know, one of the things you learn if you have good mentors, and I did in this work, is that for everything you think you know, for everything you've read in a book or that you've seen in a documentary film or that you learned in a critical theory class of some type or another up at the big fancy college, there's a lot more that you don't know. And so for me, it was always about asking questions, you know, to create a sense of space where there could be growth and collaboration. If I'm in public housing, I mean, I know what I think's going on in the community to some extent. I can read what's happening in the community. I can look at the news. I know, but I don't really know, right? So I've got to go into that space and ask folks, hey, you tell me, what do you see when it comes to your interactions with law enforcement, when it comes to your kids' interactions with teachers? What are you seeing? What are you experiencing? And how can we work together, you know, to do something about that instead of coming in with my own agenda and thinking that I know what the problems are and how to solve them? I might have an idea, but I might find out that my idea is totally wrong. So some sort of enforced humility, I think, is one of the big things, and real active listening, you know, learning to, and then the third thing is really learning to look for important aspects of what we could call activism that maybe don't seem to be about activism. I think sometimes we get in these spaces and we're wanting to make change, and everyone thinks that what that means is, you know, you're at the protest, you're at the demonstration, you've got the bullhorn, you're carrying a sign, you're banging on the doors of power. And sometimes what I learned in this work is that, you know, some of the most radical stuff that you can do, especially as a white person in this work, is not real sexy and not real glamorous, but really important. So as an example, I met some anti-racist activists years ago in Seattle, really great folks, many of them still there doing this work. And they talked about how, you know, there was a meeting of Black leaders that were wanting to do, so I don't remember what the action was. I don't know if it was about police brutality or what the issue was, but there was a group of Black folks that really needed to have a strategy session to determine what their response was going to be to whatever it was that was going on. And what the white folks did was they listened to what the Black folks asked them to do and needed them to do, which was not come to the meeting and give your opinion and get on the agenda and tell us the steps that we ought to take. Instead, what they needed the white folks to do was to do childcare for their kids, for the Black folks' kids, so they could go to the meeting. You all need to take care of our kids. Maybe y'all can cook the food. Maybe y'all can deliver the food. Maybe y'all can take our kids off our hands for a few hours so that we can go and do our thing. And I remember hearing that and thinking, what an amazing thing that one usually doesn't think about, because the thing that an activist or a social justice warrior of any kind, and I use that phrase, you know, not as a negative the way some do, is you're always looking for how you can get in the mix and really be out there in front. And what they were saying, what the Black folks were saying was, well, we love y'all and sometimes we like to hear your opinions, but right now what we need you to do is take care of our kids. And these white activists were like, hell yeah, we'll do that. And so to me, that's another way that you create space for collaboration and for growth is you do the things that maybe don't seem important, but they free up other people to do things that are really important. And that's vital too, I think.
Yeah, well, that's about also about active listening, as well as participating in a way that you wouldn't normally think would be a part of the title activist. So that's wonderful. Tell me, I wonder if you can describe a challenging situation that you found yourself in.
Yeah.
That required some unifying efforts on your part. You know, it was going south and you realized it and you needed to turn it around. How did you go about doing that?
Well, the one that immediately comes to mind, you know, like I said, we all sometimes move in these spaces in a clumsy way. And yeah. That's an understatement of somewhat biblical proportions. You know, 10 years ago, approximately, a little more than 10 years ago, I really stepped in it in social media and was really rude and cruel in the way that I responded to some people who had challenged me. Now, I to this day will tell you that the initial challenge was still the initial challenge that was put to me was still rooted in some bullshit. Like, I will tell you that. But it was okay. Really sort of an absurd attack. But the fact that it was an absurd attack is all the more reason I should have just said, you know what? Okay, I'm just gonna, you know, not gonna let it get to me, right? Because it's silly anyway.
But I didn't. It lit your fuse.
I didn't. I was in a mood, and I had been, you know, my ex-wife and I were had just moved into the house that we were in, which is stressful. I'd been getting death threats for months from neo-Nazis, and all of a sudden now I'm getting really slammed by this other anti-racist person or self-proclaimed anti-racist person. And I just went off, and I was mean and foul and cruel and an asshole in every way, shape, and form. That's what I was. Yeah. And I got called out, as I should have, for saying things the way that I did. And this went on for several days. Ultimately, at the end of this week or so process, I happened to be going on a national television show. I was on Kamau Bell's talk show that he had for a while on FXX. And I get there and the producer said, you know, we got to talk about this. And I'm like, yeah, I know we got to talk about it. And so, you know, my way of trying to deal with that situation was to go on national television, and because I had that platform, and to apologize for my tone, my behavior, acknowledge that it was completely unacceptable, so that even if I had a legitimate point to make about the wrongness of the initial attack on me, I needed to be both strong enough personally, but also as a white person, mindful, because the person who initially attacked me was a woman of color. Mm. And I needed to dial it back. It wasn't necessary for me to respond to her at all, really. And it certainly wasn't necessary for me to respond in the way that I did. Mm. And so by owning that, and then for years after, I mean, I still go to events where people bring that up. And the one thing I feel good about is, well, if the only thing you really got is something from 10 years ago where I lost my shit, I feel pretty good about that. Like, you don't have any more recent examples because I've generally behaved myself, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
But it was that, again, the humility, the ability to just sit with the criticism and to acknowledge that even if I disagree with your initial criticism, I got to be able to take that because I know where it came from. I know it comes from a place of real hurt. There are folks of color, women of color in particular, who don't feel that anybody listens to them. And when they see a white guy getting a lot of attention for saying the things that they no doubt have said for the better part of their lives, I can understand why it would be like, screw this guy. You know, who the hell is he? Because no one's listening to them and they ought to be listening to them. Now, I've tried to make that point all through my career. But if you don't know that that's who I am, if you don't know that I've tried to do that, if you have no connection to me, how would you know anything about me other than, oh, that's that jackass that I see on CNN or on YouTube or whatever, and to hell with him. I get it. Right.
Yeah.
So for me, the way to turn things around, particularly when you're the reason they've gone south, so to speak, right, is you just have to, you've got to be willing to take the hit and acknowledge that you screwed up and just say you're wrong and say that you're sorry and mean it. Not I'm sorry if I offended you, but I'm sorry that I acted in an offensive way. Mm. I'm sorry that I did this thing that was totally unacceptable. And I hope if I do it again, call me out again, but I'm going to work real hard not to.
Yeah.
And I've tried to do that, you know, since then.
Yeah, well, it's the adage I spout off quite often is we can disagree so long as we're not disagreeable.
Right. And you can even be disagreeable if you need to be in that moment. And every time someone's disagreeable with you, though, we don't have to fire back. And I need to be mindful that that only escalates the situation. But the problem is that, like I said, though, this took place on social media. Mm-hmm. If this had been someone at one of my audiences getting up in the Q&A and challenging me, it wouldn't have been nearly as vitriolic, probably on either side, because
you're face to face.
Because you're having to look at somebody.
Yes, exactly.
I mean, see the expression on their face. You're usually not going to be as cruel as you will be behind a keyboard, you know, where you don't have to see the person. So her initial attack on me probably would have been not as vitriolic. My response to her certainly would not have been nearly as vitriolic. I am very ecumenical when people attack me during the Q&A, because I want to have a dialogue. That's fine. We can do that. Right. But boy, social media, they, you know, it's like, that is just tailor-made for being an asshole, you know? And so if you're in sort of an asshole place,
look out,
you know, you should probably put down the keyboard, walk away and go jog or something, you know?
Right. Right. Unless, of course, it's the person disagreeing with you is Christopher Rufo. And then it's
right. In which case, well, A, you can't get away from him. And B, some people just deserve to be, you know, put on blast all the time. But if it's someone, my point being, if it's someone, especially someone who you know shares your commitments and your values, and they're just attacking you because they don't like the way you're doing it, like, just take the hit, listen to what they're saying. And if you conclude that they're full of it, okay. But you don't have to tell the world that you think they're full of it. You know they're full of it. You think they're full of it. You can walk away from it. And they can do the same from you. And I think if we all sort of, particularly those of us who are white, just have the ability to say, you know what, I don't have to get the last word in, you know? I don't have to defend my honor. Either my work will speak for itself or it won't.
Right.
Right. If someone thinks that I'm full of it and they don't want to read my stuff and they don't want to, okay, that's okay. I don't have to take that personally. If you don't know me personally, why would I care what you think about me? Now, if you were a friend and all of a sudden you turned on me, that'd probably send me to the therapist for several months. You know? But if you don't know me other than some online persona, have at it, man. It's fine. It's fine.
Yeah. This is a little bit of an impossible question to some degree, but I'm going to ask you if there's one thing that you could recommend to our listeners that could act as a catalyst for a more inclusive society or workplace, what would that be?
It's going to seem esoteric, but I mean it. I think that the most important thing is honesty. And by that, I just mean a real transparency around how that space, whether it's the workplace or the neighborhood where you live or the entire town where you live or the school your kids attend, how did it get undiverse? How did it get unrepresentative? How did it get so monocultural? If it is, if you're trying to make it more diverse and more inclusive, the first question is, why are we having to make efforts to do that? How did it end up not inclusive in the first place? And a lot of times we don't ask that question. We just sort of leapfrog over it. And if you leapfrog over it and you don't stare in the face the thing that brought about the condition that you're trying to change, you're not probably going to be able to reverse engineer it in a way that changes that systemic reality. So that means a deep dive into the history of your neighborhood, the history of your community, who was allowed to live there and who wasn't, and when did that change, if it did, who was allowed to go to those schools and who was not, and when did that change? Yeah. What does your workplace look like? The history of that firm that you work at, or that organization you work for, or the whatever it is. Like, I think we can all do that. We can all begin to do our own sort of truth and reconciliation process, to refer to, you know, the process that South Africa employed after the fall of apartheid there, right? This idea, and they did it society-wide, and there were problems with the process. I'm not saying it was perfect, but conceptually, the idea of saying, let's get all of this out on the table so that we can stare it in the face and figure out the legacy that it's left us. I think if you're going to try to create inclusivity and equity, that's the first and most important step. And the reason you know it's the most important step is that is the step that the Chris Rufos of the world, who you mentioned a second ago, mm-hmm. are trying to eradicate. The reason they're going after books in school, the reason they're trying to manipulate and to massage and to manage what young people can and cannot learn about, is that if you don't learn the truth of how we ended up in this place that we are today with regard to racial inequity, then you won't ever think that anything needs to be fixed. If you don't understand the history and how it relates to the present, if you don't understand the inertia of hundreds of years of injustice and inequality, then you'll end up that 15 or 16-year-old who just looks around and doesn't realize that history didn't start last week. right? Yeah. That actually there's a long legacy. And the problem is we generally haven't done a very good job of teaching the truth. And as soon as we started to, at least in some schools a few years back, that's when the right lost its mind, right? And decided that this was a great threat. So there's a reason in the midst of the uprising after George Floyd's murder, right? That's when they started attacking so-called critical race theory. That's when they started wanting to pull books from the shelves and stop DEI trainings, because they realized there was a shift in the conversation in this country, right? Yeah. The movement, even though it didn't really secure major systemic changes like with policing or the justice system, it did move the needle on the narrative. And narrative movement is the first step towards social change in every society. And so when they saw the narrative start to shift, now you got these young people out in the streets, including a lot of young white people, and they're using terms like systemic racism and white supremacy. Man, you can imagine. Yes. For those folks, we got to shut down truth. Mm-hmm. So if the thing they're trying to shut down is truth, first and foremost, that ought to tell you what the most important element of this work is being honest and transparent about how we got here.
Yeah, I love that. I had a guest in a previous podcast to African-American guy who, when he asked this question, his simple answer was, why? Use the question why, which is being honest and transparent. Why is the community like it is? Why is the makeup of the community woefully undiverse? Why are we having this discussion after so many years? Why are you trying to squelch our history and whatnot? So in many ways, it's the same kind of thing. Yeah. I also just heard Secretary Lonnie Bunch was speaking about, there's a series of essays on Reconstruction in the Atlantic magazine coming up. And he was talking about the history and the museum that he put together in Washington, D.C. and the importance and the weight of that history. So that's really great.
Yeah, which, I mean, I'm waiting with, I probably shouldn't say this out loud and speak it into the universe. I've been worried about, you know, if Congress finds out that this governmentally funded museum talks about systemic injustice and the history of anti-blackness, among other things, man, I'm afraid they're going to try to shut it down, right? Because it's a beautiful institution. It's an amazing museum. It tells an incredible history. Lonnie did a fantastic job with setting it up, but it is, you know, rooted in an analysis that is exactly the analysis that they're trying to shut down, which is black truth. So don't tell Congress, right? Like, don't let them know.
I think they got enough on their plates right now. But so as long as we're talking about honesty, and this next question sort of dovetails into that. So, you know, we would agree that we perceive definitions to particular words in slightly differently. Everybody perceives it slightly differently. And of course, we come to the table with our own set of biases. But if I were to ask you what it means to be authentic, how would you describe that? And what does that look like for you?
I think that to be authentic is to acknowledge, number one, particularly around these issues, is to acknowledge that no matter how committed you are to social change around racial injustice, that as long as you are in this society, especially if you're white, but even if you're a person of color, you will be implicated in the injustices of that society. We can't escape them entirely, from the products that we purchase to the places where we live to the jobs we have. As long as injustice is happening and we in any way have benefited from it, if we have in any way reaped the benefits of an advanced economy that, let's be honest, was built on the backs of enslavement, on the backs of injustice, on the backs of stolen land, right? And those whose land was stolen, then we're all implicated. So part of being authentic is acknowledging that, realizing that there's not good people here, bad people here, and we're the good people fighting the bad people. We're just all people. And we're people who are caught in a bad system. And when you're caught in a bad system, it is an open question as to whether you will change the system or the system will change you. So authenticity requires, first and foremost, and that's another form of humility. I come back to that a lot because I think, you know, American culture, for anyone, not just white people, does not encourage humility. And this is one of the reasons that Donald Trump, you know, is like the perfect avatar for what this culture is in a lot of ways, because he's the least humble person, right? There's nothing about this man that says humility. Everything is bragging. Everything is I'm the best. Everything is I can fix every problem. And that speaks to the American sort of psyche, which is you don't apologize for anything. You always puff yourself up. Everything's about PR. Everything's about lacking humility. Humility is weakness. Empathy is weakness. So authenticity, and it's totally inauthentic. Authenticity requires the humility and the empathy that the society and the culture are trying to wring out of us. And it's hard to get back to that when every other aspect of your culture says, don't apologize. I mean, just the thing that I did earlier when I talked about how I screwed up so badly 10 years ago, like, no, you're not supposed to do that. You're supposed to double down. And originally I did double down. That's what got me in the most trouble. I'm like, God, why did I do that? And then I tripled down. And then finally I was like, oh my God, what have I just done? And saying that, you know, you're sorry or that you were wrong is an incredibly liberating thing, whether you're saying that about activism or whether you're saying that about a relationship that you're in or a friendship that has gone off the rails or whatever. Like, just, you know, that level of humility and, again, transparency, I think, is crucial.
I cannot agree more. Just, it's such a relief to let that stuff go, to just not have to hold on to that, you know. And I think humility is a wonderful way to let it go, to bring yourself into compliance with understanding that we're all in this together, and that you're not my enemy.
Well, and the biggest part of humility to me, I mean, there's sort of three levels that we need it, right? One is we need humility around our accomplishments, because none of us make it alone, right? We all we had family, we had mentors, we had teachers, we had coaches, we had friends, we were lucky to have certain experiences that maybe other people didn't have. So number one is humility around that, which means letting go of the notion of rugged individualism and the myth of meritocracy and being real about how any of us make it if we make it. The second is humility around our knowledge base. Like, the fact is, if you and I know something to be true, well, is that just because we're so smart that we thought of it ourselves, or is it that we got exposed to some knowledge or some information? If I happen to read a book that maybe you didn't read, I can't take credit for the fact that I happened to come upon that book. Like, I need to be humble about what I know. And then the problem is, in our culture around racism, what we have is a lot of people who want to sort of shame people who don't know stuff yet. Right. And so it's the opposite of humility. But how can I jump down your throat on Friday for something that I didn't really know until Tuesday, metaphorically speaking, right? Like, right. If I didn't know, how can I get mad at you? So humility around our knowledge base is also really important. Yes. The third one is be humble about whether you are right or not, right? Like there's somebody, I don't know if it was Aristotle, I'm not sure who it was, that said that the spirit of democracy is the spirit of, you know, acknowledging that you might be wrong. That's not Aristotle. He wouldn't have said that, but somebody said that. and I think that that's true, right? The idea that, I mean, look, I have very strong opinions and I think I'm right about the stuff that I believe, but holding out the possibility that I might have a blind spot around something or I might be missing something, even if I'm really confident that that's not true, just that having that voice that says, you know what, I could be wrong, so I got to keep learning and I got to keep listening and I have to keep engaging. That humility too would go a long way. Right. And I just think we don't do a lot of that. We see a lot of that right now happening with the conflict between Israel and Palestine and what's going on in Palestine right now and in Gaza. This idea that everybody thinks they know for sure what the truth is. Now, I'm not saying there's no such thing as truth. I'm not making some kind of argument that there's no such thing as objective reality. What I'm saying is there may be truth, but the odds are you might not have it yet.
Right.
Right. And right. I might not have it yet. I know what I think. Right. And here's the evidence for what I think. But you can look at the very same set of facts and come to a whole different conclusion.
That's
and
right.
We're both smart people. We're both observant people. So how is that possible? Well, I know the answer to that from social psychology tells me that the reason we're seeing the same things differently is because of different upbringing, what we were exposed to, all kinds of subjective things. So acknowledging that subjectivity is part of the humility too, that I think we need if we're going to move forward as a productive society.
Absolutely. That is a wonderful place to sort of put a button on this conversation. I could talk to you for a long time, but I want to ask you one last question that maybe you could share with listeners, something that is inspiring you. Maybe you could recommend a book, a movie, a play, a television show, or all of the above, something that has been inspiring you, and tell us why.
Well, gosh, there are a lot of things that I could choose, but since he's in the frame, I'm going to point over here to James Baldwin on the wall.
Yes.
And I say this a lot, and people, I'm sure they get to the point where it's like, oh my God, another person that's discovered James Baldwin. But I've been reading Baldwin since I was in high school or early in college. And I will tell you that when things seem like they're going off the rails in this country, which is every week, I find myself going back and rereading his essays, and there is literally something for every crisis that we face now. You will find something that he wrote about that speaks to it directly. And it's almost uncanny, the level of the prescience and the realization that Baldwin had of our condition as a country. And so I go back, I pull it off the shelf. It's all dog-eared and marked up and all that. But it's like, you know, I can't say things better than Baldwin did. So sometimes it's like, here's something Baldwin said, think about it, you know? So for me, that's always been a source of great inspiration. Beyond that, I'm really inspired by the way that young people who get a bad rap, I think, you know, we talk all kinds of negativity about Gen Z. We talk about them like they, you know, they don't know what they're doing, and they're arrogant, and they're lazy, and they don't want to. These are people that are leading some of the most important activist struggles right now around the world. You know, whether we're talking about climate change, or we're talking about racial justice, or we're talking about fighting for, you know, better wages and healthcare. You got young people that are involved in a lot of these labor actions around the country, and the revitalization of the union movement in this country. A lot of that's been pretty young people, certainly younger millennials and older Gen Z folks. So, you know, I'm very much inspired by young people. Maybe it's because, you know, I'm a father to two young women who inspire me every day. And so I just think I think sometimes we have to remember that young people make the same mistakes that we made when we were younger. And we would have loved it if somebody had been inspired by the nonsense that we were doing and the good stuff that we were doing. So we need to take inspiration from young people, even when they mess up.
Yeah.
Even when they mess up, because messing up is part of the process of becoming better at advocating for a better society and a more just society. So that inspires me too.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Tim. Thanks for this conversation. I really, really appreciate it.
You bet. Thank you.
Thanks again for listening to Authenticity, Belonging, Community, the podcast that explores the ABCs of inclusivity. For those who are new to the podcast, welcome. We appreciate you listening and hope you discovered something here that will make you want to revisit as well as share with others. And if you're a returning listener to the podcast, formerly known as Incognito the Podcast, we hope the new brand aligns with what you've come to expect from the show. In our continuing journey to expand our listenership, I'm making the big ask of you to help share and spread the word. I've raved many a time on this podcast about what a delight it is to speak with the wide variety of guests we've had, and how each episode offers so much to take away and learn from. I hope you will rave as well. I welcome your comments, suggestions, and reviews. Until next week, keep asking questions.